Terrific. Good afternoon. Let's kick off because Peter Mandelson has to leave absolutely on the dot of two. Anyway, very warm welcome. I'm Bronwen Maddox. I'm Director of the Institute for Government, and we're delighted to see you here today to hear from Lord Mandelson, who is the Chairman of Global Counsel, the Chairman and Founder of Global Counsel, the strategic advisory organization, and held, as you know, a great number of posts under Tony Blair and Gordon Brown, and crucially, for the purposes
which we
can even dig into, and crucially, was Trade Commissioner for the European Union between 2004 and 2008. And I remember Brussels officials, when he took over, saying it was regarded, you know, some sort of testing skepticism every time they got a new trade commissioner. Would that person really get to grips with the detail of the brief? And after a really very short spell of weeks, not months, they gave full tribute to Peter Mandelson's panoramic grasp of that most complex brief.
I can assure
it was
you.
The middle of a row as well with the Americans as
it
well.
It didn't feel like that at the time, but anyway.
No, I'm not one for unearned flattery. I remember that very well. Very warm welcome, and thank you for discussing the UK after Brexit and indeed governing a divided country. And you kindly offered to kick off with some remarks.
Yeah, Bronwen, if I may, because this is a complex area, and I want to be precisely right in the way in which I frame our conversation. Let me, if I may, just share some initial remarks with everyone about the current state of play on Brexit, the negotiation, and how the domestic politics and a little bit of the European politics are playing out on this. Now, the Prime Minister has made two absolutely pivotal decisions which will determine the shape of Brexit and the negotiation which is now getting underway. First, her preemptive choice, in my view, to leave the single market in order to pursue a free trade agreement as a third country completely outside the European Union. This will certainly add time, complexity, and considerable risk to the negotiation. Second, her negotiating strategy is framed by a series of red lines, which on the face of it will severely restrict her negotiating flexibility. Now, we know where these red lines have come from, and they present the Prime Minister with a serious choice. It's a choice essentially between the trade deal that she regards as and is indeed essential for our future economy, on the one hand, and the right wing of her party on the other, who want Brexit at any cost. And she has an existential choice to navigate her way through between what she believes the national interest requires and what the right wing of her party demands. It's essentially a choice between economic reality and political intransigence. Now, the EU, in response, has set out draft negotiating guidelines which offer a clear route to a comprehensive future trade deal between the UK and the EU. It's their olive branch. In effect, they're saying to Britain, you can have your trade deal, but in order to get it, you have to respect our rules. In other words, if we meet you halfway, you have got to do similarly. Now, the Prime Minister asked for a proper negotiation, and the EU are giving her a proper negotiation. It will be a negotiation in two parts, but it will be eventually a seamless negotiation. First, the withdrawal, and then the re-engagement. Over time, as I say, these discussions will overlap. They will, as I say, morph into a single negotiation with two deals as a result, which will be struck at different moments. Complicated. She always knew that the terms on which the EU would set out this negotiation. I mean, all her officials, UKRET, FCO, DEXU, all spelled them out very clear from the beginning. There are no particular surprises in the EU's guidelines, Gibraltar apart. Now, I hope that the EU will be reasonable, constructive, and businesslike in its approach throughout. The question is, though, will the Prime Minister's party allow her to do similarly, or are they going to set out to tie her hands and dog her at every stage in this negotiation? If she has freedom to negotiate properly, she will need to reach agreement on the following. Payments. The Prime Minister says Britain will cease to make large payments to the EU, but their guidelines make clear that they expect a single financial settlement to cover liabilities, future membership, and our participation in future EU programmes and agencies. So payments, she's got to reach agreement on that, which I believe is doable. Timetable and transition. The EU says we will depart in March 2019, but that a trade deal could only be completed and ratified once the UK has left and become a third country. There will therefore have to be a transition period after 2019, which the EU says at the moment it will limit to 3 years. Now, this in turn will require two, possibly three, further areas of compromise by the British government. First of all, on the ECJ. In a transition period, the UK is likely to have to remain under the jurisdiction of the European Court of Justice, directly or indirectly, perhaps in a structure like the EFTA Court. And even after this, under the terms of a free trade agreement, the EU has made it clear that it expects a level playing field in rules governing competition policy, state aid, fiscal, social, and environmental standards. Level playing field between the UK and the EU as a basis for a future free trade agreement. This will limit Britain's regulatory freedom and be subject to arbitration by the ECJ or its equivalent on a continuing basis. Free movement. Any transition period that maintained the status quo in trade would mean retaining the four freedoms, including freedom of movement. We can decide not to do this, but this will come at a cost of, I think, very restricted market access in services during that period and thereafter. And lastly, on international trade agreements, Britain may have to delay the start of actual negotiations for new deals with other countries, as opposed to scoping them out, until after we are through the extended transition period and fully outside the customs union. Now, the wild men in her party have already started to agitate against accepting any such terms, which they think would amount to a bad deal. They claim that no deal would be better than such a bad deal, that no deal would be absolutely okay, in the Foreign Secretary's words, which means, let's just bear in mind what that means, no future preferential trade agreement at all for Britain with the European Union. Now, let's be clear what no future trade deal would mean for Britain. It would mean WTO tariffs operating, imposed on around 90% of the goods the UK exports to the European Union, tariffs which would include 36% tariffs on dairy, 15% on other food, 11% on textiles, 10% on cars, and I could go on. We're not talking about some mean average 2 or 3%. We're talking about specifically much higher tariffs on a whole range of different goods. Service trade would be severely restricted because of regulatory non-harmonisation, non-compliance between the EU and UK. And it would also mean customs checks and inspections, which would be lengthy and costly. That's where you see the begin to see the lorries banked up behind up the road from Dover. Now, there would, of course, as a result of no trade deal being agreed, be costs for European traders, no doubt. But given that half our exports go into the European market, the economic consequences for Britain would be much greater. I don't think leaving without a trade deal in prospect, by the way, would receive parliamentary approval. But let's just bear in mind what it would mean. It would mean a big impact on market confidence as far as Britain is concerned, an impact on interest rates and the cost of borrowing, and on the value of the pound. All these consequences would be severe. And it would be the most vulnerable, the most indebted in our society, and the ones with least to fall back on, who would suffer fastest and most. Now, to those who say we have to countenance no deal as a negotiating tactic, I would just say that threatening to shoot yourself in both feet is really not a credible negotiating tactic. It is instead a sign of insanity. Threatening the EU on security cooperation has already got us nowhere. Indeed, it's gone down very badly. So where does this leave domestic politics in conclusion? In my view, to withstand the internal party pressures on her, the Prime Minister clearly needs broader political support in Parliament and in the country. She needs others to place weight on the other side of the scales. In particular, I believe it is the moral duty of Brexiters in the Cabinet to weigh in and challenge those who claim that no deal would be fine, as the Chancellor did during his visit to India yesterday in very clear and not to say outspoken terms, certainly too outspoken for the Daily Mail's tastes. Now, here's the point though. She has to be honest about both the compromise needed to achieve a deal and the consequences of not getting it. The Prime Minister has got to spell this out. Nobody but her can do it properly for the country. I think that such honesty would be a sign of her strength and of her determination and not weakness. Above all, she has to make clear that the national interest has to come first and that a trade deal is absolutely essential to secure this. Based on my experience as a member of the Commission, I believe her straight dealing would be reciprocated on the EU side. I think it would create a positive momentum for the negotiation from the outset, and I think it would help to build trust in the negotiation throughout. If she fights for her position against those wishing to drag her further and further away from it. I think most of the country will back her. And I think it would be churlish for people like me, very strongly in the Remain camp, not to wish her well, even though I think, and I feel this passionately, even though I think that a free trade agreement is a clear second best to staying fully in the single market. In effect, what I'm saying is that the Leave people should not tie her hands during this negotiation, and those of us in the Remain camp should back her up in the negotiation without, of course, giving blanket support for any outcome. It really does have to be a real trade deal with content and not some matter of political optics. If she gives in my view, to the wild men and to the right of her party, I think she will only have herself to blame when the awful reality of our position dawns, and it will. There will then be no blaming the Remainers by her, no blaming the Remainers or the EU. She will have brought this on herself if she gives in at any stage during this negotiation to these people in her party. So as the negotiation gets underway, I really do believe the Prime Minister faces a fork in the road. And a huge amount is riding in her choice, either to stand up to the pressure being exerted on her and see off and face down those who are trying to drag her away from her current position, or simply see her position progressively erode. I think all of us need to hope that she takes the right choice, that she stands fully with the national interest, fully for a preferential trade deal, faces down those in her party who want to drag her away. But one thing is sure, if she doesn't do that, then she will simply see, in my view, as I say, her position progressively erode until we find ourselves not just out of the European Union, but without any preferential trade agreement to govern the trade between our country and that market, our home market in effect, which takes at the moment half our exports.
Peter, thank you for that. One of the first, most full-on attacks on the idea that no deal is acceptable, was even a credible negotiating position that I think we've heard, even though, as you say, she's starting from a point that you wouldn't have chosen in having ruled out the single market and the customs union. You talk about the wild men very memorably, indeed. We're talking about them before you turned up today in anticipation of this talk. And as you've made clear, some of those wild men, or as you put it right now, some of those wild men are in her cabinet in terms of some of the remarks the Foreign Secretary's made.
And they do all seem to be men.
Andrea Leadsom.
Andrea Leadsom, is she still in the cabinet? Haven't seen hide nor hair.
I was wondering as you were talking just how much Theresa May would welcome this emphatic speech of support for her. What is more trouble, do you think, to her? The voices in the cabinet or outside in the party?
Well, it's the voices in the party finding expression in the cabinet. And there is obviously a reason why Boris Johnson has chosen to speak out as he has. He wants to be the champion and the beneficiary of that point of view when, as they hope, it all goes pear-shaped and Brexit becomes a train wreck. And let's be absolutely clear, they are prepared. They are people who are prepared to see the country pay any price for this. You know, they are ideologues. They're not rationalists. They're people who have fought for 20+ years to get to this position. And they feel, I think, all the time that they're just about to be cheated, that somehow defeat is going to be snatched from the jaws of their great victory in this civil war into which the entire country was sort of dragged through the referendum, and that therefore they have to bounce up out of bed every day and keep fighting, looking for every chance or risk that they might be betrayed by their own Prime Minister during the course of this negotiation. And what I say the Prime Minister needs is this, and let's just understand, it is not easy as a Prime Minister to govern such a divided country as we are over Europe. But what she has to do to be successful in governing such a divided country is first of all to be very clear and consistent in her aims. Secondly, during the course of the negotiation, she has to build up trust all the time. And thirdly, she has to retain the flexibility to reach a deal in the final analysis. And of those three things, I mean, the clarity, the trust, and the negotiating flexibility, I think the most important is to be absolutely clear and consistent in what your objectives are, for two reasons. First of all, as I know, having been a negotiator of trade agreements on the European Union's behalf for 4+ years, the moment you lose, you know, your own sort of bearings and your own compass, it becomes very difficult for you to pursue clear negotiating objectives. But secondly, if you're not clear and you're not consistent, you're not allowing the people across the table to calibrate clearly as they need to do exactly where you stand and the strength or room for flexibility or compromise you have in different positions, which then informs their own negotiating tactics. If you're negotiating with somebody, in other words, Bronwen, who is sort of really wobbling around all over the place the whole time, always sort of looking over their shoulder and trying to appease the people behind you rather than negotiate clearly with the people in front of you, you won't be able to build up the necessary trust, and I think you'll forsake the necessary flexibility that in the end you'll need in order to strike that deal.
So would you suggest, for example, that she does in fact say that any deal is better than no deal?
I think, you know, when you go into a negotiation like this, you've certainly not got to appear desperate for a deal, obviously. I mean, you know,
you don't want to appear
so desperate that you're just sort of prepared to lay there sort of prostrate in front of the people you're negotiating with. No. But nor can you adopt a sort of posture and a series of tactics which are so destructive that you can't actually get the negotiation to the conclusion you want to reach. So you've got to be neither desperate nor destructive. And she's got to sort of strike the right balance between those two poles in her sort of body language and composure during this negotiation, which in my view, she's doing better now than she was doing certainly during the autumn or when we went into the new year. I thought that her initial speech to the Conservative Party conference was wildly destructive. It was as if she were just sort of saying to the EU27, you know, we'll do you a favour by negotiating with you. We'll let you know what we want in due course, and you can like it or lump it, and good luck. You know, thank you very much. No, thank you. I think that she adopted a more measured tone in her Lancaster House speech. And I think that the letter to Tusk was not just more measured, I thought it was more balanced in its tone. So I think that she is trying to strike that right sort of position between, you know, sounding desperate and sounding destructive, but she has got to sustain it. I mean, people have to know on the EU27 side who they're negotiating with, you know, what her objectives are, and where the room and scope for manoeuvre is. If they don't, and you just see this sort of shifting person in front of the table in front of you, you'll never get anywhere.
Well, if you're talking about body language and composure, then obviously that's, you know, it might be fairly easily fixed, and indeed the Daily Mail can then go and analyse that. But if you, we risk having something slightly less than clear, because on the one hand you're saying, look, she's got to be really honest, talking to British people at the moment, and talking to her party, saying, we really are going to have to compromise in this, because no deal would be a really, really bad outcome for us. And on the other hand, we don't want her to look entirely compliant with the EU and as if she's desperate for a deal. And it seems to me
it's
difficult.
I'm not saying it's easy. It's hard, the position she's in. But one thing also she shouldn't do with the British public is feed them unrealistic expectations. This idea that Britain can have its cake and eat it in this, all that's going to do is to dash expectations when people find they can't have their cake and eat it. There will be a public backlash then and a further erosion of trust in politicians and in the government. That would be, you know, the worst approach she could take, in my view, in her handling of the country as a whole during the course of this negotiation.
We've talked about the sequence that Europe wants, the exit talks followed by a trade deal. How long do you think a trade deal might take?
Well, if you were to take the sort of formal position of the EU on this, you would say, you know, 2 years spent negotiating the exit, the withdrawal, the disentanglement, at which point when we get that agreement, we can then move seamlessly on to the next stage of the negotiation, because Britain will have left the EU in March 2019, let's say, we become a third country and we start negotiating afresh as a third country outside the tent, outside the family with the EU, and if we were to literally start at that point without having done any preparation or any scoping out or teeing up of the negotiation, that would take, in my view, a good 3 to 5 years. You know, and I'm being optimistic. I don't think it will happen like that. I think that we could move on to the sort of teeing up and the scoping out informally at some stage during the next 2 years, not immediately, but at some stage. And I know from my own experience in negotiating trade deals that the more time and effort and imagination you invest in the scoping out before the formal negotiation gets underway, the easier the negotiation itself becomes. I mean, I can think of countless occasions, having said that, I can't actually think. I can give you two examples. South Korea and Singapore, where you had true trade negotiators, EU, South Korea, very clever minister, very energised, very on the ball, seemed to have completely in control of his own negotiating position and his own mandate. And we had basically scoped out exactly what we were going to achieve and when we were going to end up before almost even the actual negotiation began. Similarly with Singapore. So you can do it, but I want to make this caveat, and I want to make a suggestion as well. The caveat is that if the negotiation on your withdrawal, on your disentanglement has gone very badly, soured the atmosphere, and sort of corroded trust, you know, on both sides of the negotiating table, which is indeed possible, it will make the second stage of the negotiation much more difficult to undertake. It may even sink it completely. And therefore, what I think the government has got to do is to bite on the bullet on the exit, bite on the bullet on the money, as it were. Say, look, we know we're going to have to do this. We're going to get there. Let's do it sooner rather than later, so that we can then retain as much time as possible, as much negotiating goodwill, as much trust and good atmospherics to focus and invest in the really important negotiation for us, which is about our future trading relationship. So I would just settle the tab, pay the money, do it as quickly as possible. It's not going to be a vast sum of money. I mean, it will be a vast sum of money, but I mean, you know, in the sort of, you know, I mean, as a percentage of our public spending and our GDP in this country, given that it's going to be paid over very many years, it's small change. And I would deal with the small change of the financial settlement in the first negotiation as quickly as you can in order to advance in as propitious a way as you can to the second stage of the negotiation, which is about the future trade arrangement.
It's a brave argument, and it has a lot of force behind it, but a lot of people might recoil from that phrase, small change. Indeed, the Prime Minister, who'd have to make that argument, as you said, very, very early to the country and her party, that let's get over this immediate hurdle of a lump of money with a figure on it.
Prime Minister, I think you need to be brave in your approach to this. And she would need to be brave, and she would need to do it, bite on the bullet and move on and get into the real meat of this whole negotiation, which is how we're going to secure the continuity of our trade in our largest export market in the long term. That's what we really need to focus on.
What's the range of money that we might consider small
know.
Change in that?
I really don't know. No, it's a very good question. Very good question.
Yeah. Just tell us a bit about the European side. I mean, we hear an awful lot at the moment about the British side and Britain trying to get its position together. And obviously, there are 27 countries there, and it all got distilled into Donald Tusk's outline of how it was going to happen. But, you know, in terms of the European Union countries putting together a negotiating position on trade, who's really calling the shots on that, and what are the key sensitivities going to be?
Well, the people outwardly and actually calling the shots will be the European Commission. And, you know, as a former member of the Commission, somebody who has negotiated on behalf of the EU through the Commission, knowing how the Commission works, being very familiar with its officials and its expertise, I must say I'm not sure that I would wish having to negotiate with the European Commission on my worst enemy. They're going to be tough. You know, they know what they're doing. They're masters of negotiations like this because, you know, that's their daily practice. That's what they do on behalf of the member states. But here's the point: once those negotiating guidelines cease to be draft and become actual, and the mandate is set down for the Commission can't deviate. The Commission can't go off on a journey of its own, making it up as it goes along. It has to stay absolutely within the guidelines and the negotiating mandate agreed by all the member states, and it will be accountable to the member states and to the Sherpas in this negotiation. I suspect Commission will, and Michel Barnier will need to meet those Sherpas regularly. I mean, if not once a week, then certainly two or three times a month in order to maintain his accountability. He would be very ill-advised if he did not, during the course of these negotiations, take into account, you know, the special needs and special requirements of particular member states. Ireland obviously comes to mind notably, because if he fails to do that, he will be tripped up further down the road when that member state is able to come back and say, you didn't adhere faithfully, you didn't deliver properly on this part of your negotiating guidelines. If he at any stage gives the sense that some sort of personal animus is entering this negotiation,
for whatever reason, from whatever quarter, he will be marked down by the member states. They will want the entire thing conducted in the most professional and business-like way possible. So he has to be very careful that he maintains his objectivity and retains command over his body language throughout. And knowing Barnier, I think he will do that well. I think he's a professional. He's somebody who bears no personal malice or anything like it towards Britain. He knows Britain well. He dealt with the internal market and financial services, so he knows the city exceptionally well. And he will know too that whatever is the result of Brexit, the City of London will continue to be Europe's preeminent financial centre. He will realise that. Yes, it will become smaller and dollops of people and activity will be redeployed elsewhere, much of it, I fear, out of Europe altogether, back to New York. But Britain will lose, London will lose bits and pieces, but we will remain the preeminent financial centre. And on that will depend the capital raising and the trading and the financial transactions of a vast swathe of the continental European economy. So it has to work. He knows how it works, and therefore he will know how to maintain it in good working order.
Do you think, in my view, this concern for balance and body language, does that apply to the European Parliament?
Well, the European Parliament. Yeah. I mean, I was mainly pre the Lisbon Treaty, therefore I, as a trade commissioner, I had pretty much carte blanche to do what I wanted without the Parliament sort of sitting on my shoulder all the time. Now it's changed, you know, they have to agree both your mandate, your negotiating guidelines, and they have to sign off on the final deal, and they will have to do so in this beginning and end of this trade negotiation as well. Do I think that they will want to throw a spanner in the works? Nope, I don't think they will want to do that, because they're essentially faithful to the European interest, their sort of integrity and stability of the European Union, and they know that hurling spanners is going to destabilize and it's going to create divisions in European ranks, which they will see as completely, you know, unattractive and unwelcome. Are they, however, going to, you know, not pull threads, but are they going to inspect the minutiae and the small print? Yes, they are. I mean, that's their job, that's what they do. They're very well served in order to exercise that role. They are a wonderfully conducted nest of competing interests in the European Parliament, and all those competing interests will be brought to bear on this eventual negotiation. So I think the government is wise, by the way, this week in sending off a minister from DEXU to sort of try and, you know, explain Britain's position, husband a bit of support, and, you know, try and nurture some relationships there in the European Parliament, because again, anything in that respect which is invested now will pay dividends further down the road.
Just finally, before we go to questions, we've talked about the opposition within Theresa May's party. Now, how do you think the leader of the Labour Party ought to position himself on this?
Well, look, I personally, I think that the front bench of the Labour Party, Jeremy Corbyn and Keir Starmer, took the wrong stance from the beginning on this, I'm afraid. They essentially decided to agree with the Prime Minister in her preemptive choice to exclude any future membership of the single market. Why do I think that was ill-advised? Because I think it would have been much better from Britain's point of view to allow us time and opportunity and scope to explore what sort of deal we could negotiate between us and the European Union while staying within the European Economic Area and therefore being able to participate fully in the single market. It may have been at the end of the day that the conditions attached to it were such that we simply couldn't sustain a membership of the EEA. You know, people said, oh yeah, but there'll be freedom of movement and we'll just have to accept all their rules without having any influence over them. We'll have to accept the ECJ. Wouldn't this be awful? No, we must come out of the whole thing, bag and baggage. I think that was a mistake made by the government and a mistake made by the Labour front bench in agreeing it. Because in my view, we would have got a completely different sort of negotiation between ourselves and the EU if we were conducting that negotiation as sort of insiders, people who were remaining somewhat inside the tent and part of the family in the European Economic Area, than we are going to get as outsiders, people who decided, you know, to leave the family and then simply negotiate with the European Union as third countries. I think that if we had explored and see how far we could get in, for example, yes, respecting the principle of the of freedom of movement of people, but seeing it operate differently and applied differently and managed differently. There's a mood in any case in the European Union to see changes of that sort in respect of freedom of movement. I don't think we would necessarily have had to accept simply the European Court of Justice as advertised. We would have had to have accepted elements of it or some version of it, but then we will in any case have to do that as part of a future free trade agreement. And as for influencing the rules and the regulations of the EU, which in my view is by far the most important, I think that we would, if we had said, we're leaving the EU, we're leaving the political institutional apparatus of the EU, but we want to stay in the single market, then given our size, our status, our recent 40-year membership of the EU, I think we would have been able to negotiate something much more than consultation over the rulemaking and the lawmaking as it impacted on us, certainly as far as financial services are concerned. I don't think there's any possibility of them simply treating us in the way that, you know, the terms were given to Norway, when Norway voted not to join the European Union and join the EEA instead. What would have been different is that we would have been already a member and wanting to stay somewhere within the family. We're much bigger. We have a completely different status and size of economy in Europe, unlike Norway. But also, most importantly, the EU27 would have been so pleased and relieved, not a little surprised that we were choosing, you know, to stay, as it were, somewhat in the family, then the goodwill and the constructive engagement we would have got back, I think, would have been very substantial. And I'm sorry that the Prime Minister imposed, essentially, on the Cabinet, but then it was imposed on her by her party, that we should leave the single market from the outset without even exploring the beneficial terms on which we could continue to participate in the single market as members, rather than just treating from outside by means of a free trade agreement.
I think many people agree with you. Nonetheless, she did. And we are where we are. And with the choices that you described so eloquently at the beginning. Let's have some questions. Lots. Here in the front.
Andrew Carney, trustee at the Institute, and Peter, I also negotiated on behalf of the European Commission as a chef de cabinet, and I think your explanation of how the Commission will view this and how they'll perform their duties is absolutely spot on, and one needs to understand the other side of the negotiating table. Can I ask you about a breakdown in the negotiations. John Kerr has estimated a 30% plus chance of it breaking down. I think it's a much higher percentage.
But at which stage?
That's my question. I mean, we can either break down during the negotiations, go away and then come back, or as it were, the negotiations can fail completely and we go into the outer darkness. How do you see that playing, and how should the UK negotiators deal with the pressure for a complete breakdown from some in the Conservative Party and perhaps other parties, and the dangers of doing that? I mean, how do you deal with the breakdown in negotiations?
Well, there are basically two points of danger or vulnerability. One is if the government decides that the severance terms are really too onerous, the single payment too great that is being demanded, and we simply can't find any common ground between the two positions, and the government decides to sort of walk away from that. Two consequences. First of all, we'd still be landed with a bill and pursued through international courts to pay it. Britain is not one of those countries that doesn't pay its bills, for good reason, not least the impact it would have on the markets and market confidence in our future debt raising. But secondly, I think that it would certainly make obviously impossible any future trade negotiation. We would essentially be opening ourselves to the sort of retaliatory action that we simply couldn't bear economically. I mean, you know, so we would say, well, I'm very sorry, but, you know, we're not paying the tab. We're leaving in any case. Do your damnedest. Do what you want. Pursue us through the courts. Take whatever action on the trade side that you want. We're just going to go off, thank you very much, and be global Britain and live happily ever after. Considerably poorer ever after, but, you know. The second danger, point of danger, is if we get through the exit agreement and move on to the substance of the preferential trade negotiation, and we find that the rules and the conditions which the EU side is attaching to that preferential trade arrangement are ones that politically we just find impossible to digest. And we just let those negotiations, evaporate. At which point we wouldn't have any transitional period worth its name either. We would effectively be facing a cliff edge, over which we would slide. Obviously, depending on what political forces are operating with what strength and power at those two stages, we'll determine, what the Prime Minister does. But I have no doubt at all that the country will understand what she's doing and why she's doing it. I think the country will support a proper negotiation. I don't think the country would welcome a breakdown and a subsequent Brexit train wreck. I don't think the country would repay her and the government for that at all. And I think you will then see two sorts of political calculation kicking in. The internal domestic, internal party political calculation of am I going to be the fourth Conservative Prime Minister to be crucified on the cross of Europe? Am I going to go the same way as sort of Thatcher, Major, and Cameron? Versus another political calculation which will be made and applied by the electorate, which is you've made a huge mess of this whole thing. The whole thing is disintegrated, and you know, you've played a game of poker and lost it, and it's our future prosperity that's at stake. So she is going to have to make a series of political calculations, and not for the first time the Prime Minister is going to be, in a sense, torn between her party and the public. Prime Ministers are used to that, and we just have to hope that she comes down on the right side. But it is going to be difficult, and it's going to be particularly difficult, in my view, for the first 6 to 9 months of this negotiation.
Thank you. Here on the aisle.
Thank you for that clear, rather gloomy tale. And what you say the Prime Minister needs is broader support, national interests first to be respected for that, and the country will back her. What you haven't mentioned, and I'd like to hear your view, is at what stage do the press change their tune, and what stage do they play a role? Because you say the country will back her, believe her or not, that the press seem to have played quite a big role in all of this.
Thank you. Would you like to say who you are?
Patricia Rawlings has the Lord.
I think the press is, as everyone knows, are motivated and driven by that sort of cabal of, you know, the Barclay brothers, you know, in their splendid isolation in their castle in the Channel Islands, trying to steer Brexit onto the rocks by Paul Dacre of the Daily Mail, who has an ideological fixation as well as a very venal temperament. Rupert Murdoch, of course, from either California or New York, trying to pull the strings of Britain's future as well. And between the four of them, I don't think there's any likelihood of their changing their mood or their tenor. They are on the Prime Minister's case. To date, they've had her in a sort of form of lockdown. And it's escaping free and becoming her own person and her own negotiator that the Prime Minister has got to do. And I think that she's got to realise that you only have one chance to be Prime Minister. It's not going to come again. She has one chance to be Prime Minister, and she better do it well. And if she wants a good place in the history books, she needs to steer this negotiation to a successful conclusion in the interest of the country as a whole. And that, at the end of the day, if I had to put money on it, is what she will do. But she will have a fight on her hands to withstand the pressures of the sort we've already seen operating on her, including but not only from the cabal of newspaper proprietors and editors who have done so much to drive this over the last 20 years.
Thank you. On the aisle behind the camera.
Rudy Bogni. Lord Mandelson, you mentioned your suspicion that financial activity is moving from the city to New York. This indeed is borne out by the figures already. Swaps and derivatives volumes have already shifted from London to New York. When in the 60s the USA had Regulation Q, business moved to London very quickly within the space of 2 years. Now you hinted that we may have 2 plus 3 years of negotiations. Do you really sincerely believe that the city can withstand 5 years of being caught in arbitrage between US regulation, European regulation, to which we don't know whether the UK will subscribe or not? Isn't that a bit too optimistic?
The city has deep capital pockets. It has an infrastructure and an ecosystem that supports the financial markets and services in London, which are second to none. We remain a global hub, whatever, you know, the compromise of our position in Europe is and the ceasing of our passporting rights into the single market. We remain viewed as as a global hub, attracting a lot of global capital and not just European, and we retain the ability to give a service to the rest of Europe, which is second to none in Europe. Now, I appreciate the instability, I appreciate the uncertainty of 5 years, all told, of this negotiation, but I think it is, I think the city is capable of sustaining its position during that period because of that strength it already has and because of the way people view it and like to participate in its services and its markets. But obviously, you know, if the whole thing, you know, really jumps track and looks as if it's, you know, going over a cliff, then not just the city, but so many other parts of our economy, the international investment, the Japanese car makers, you know, what Airbus does. There are so many sectors right across the waterfront of our economy that will react very, very adversely. The penalty we pay economically will be very, very severe, and not just in the financial realm. Frankly, it barely warrants thinking about, but it just makes all the more alarming and perplexing that there are vocal and influential people who are thinking about it and actually discounting the economic price we would pay, and for the sake of their sort of ideological conviction, are prepared to take us perilously near that cliff edge.
Thank you. Here, right in the front.
Hi, John Ashmore from Politics Home. Lord Mandelson, you mentioned that Theresa May might pay the electoral price if Brexit goes wrong. I mean, is there any likelihood of that if Jeremy Corbyn remains leader of the Labour Party? And how are your efforts to stop that going?
It's very difficult to speculate what the result of a general election would be when the country is faced with a choice between Theresa May and Jeremy Corbyn. Far too difficult for me to...
Okay.
I mean, what on earth would the country do in a choice between hard Brexit and the hard left? God, is this what politics in this country has come to? It's too ghastly.
It is. Here in the middle. Yeah.
And we need to do better.
Thanks. George Crozier, I work for the Chartered Institute of Taxation. I'm tempted to ask, first of all, if you remember this tie, the nearly 20 years old now?
Yeah, I remember that tie. I didn't like it at the time.
I think the Italians didn't like the
UK
pizza.
Presidency tie, 1997.
Yeah,
I hated it then. And
I don't wear it that often. And my question's about something different.
I didn't sign it off. The Foreign Office did. They thought they were being terribly sort of, cool. You know, cool Britannia about the whole thing.
Very modern. My question's about if we're negotiating a trade agreement with the EU, what you think the major stumbling blocks are likely to be, what the knotty problems are going to be that we'll still be arguing about at the 11th hour? In particular, do you think it will be a lot harder to reach agreement on services?
Much harder.
And that's, thanks.
Much harder.
And I noticed in the draft guidelines reference to provisions on fiscal dumping that I think were French government inspired, or that's the media reports. I just wondered, given that that's what certain parts of the UK government would call low competitive taxes, if you think that that is a likely stumbling block as well.
First of all, there are some people who think that as long as we pay enough into the European coffers, we'll get any sort of trade deal we want and need at the end of the day. Wrong. It's not money for access that is going to determine this. It is our compliance with the rules and regulations of the single market that are going to determine the content and quality of the free trade agreement that we get. Secondly, it is relatively easy in a trade negotiation to deal with tariffs. I mean, they're either there or they're not, and they can be progressive. Those tariff peaks that remain, and they're not that many, can be progressively reduced over time. As they are phased out, it's relatively easy to negotiate about. The real challenge is in negotiating services access and regulatory equivalence, the convergence and the mutual recognition of services, regulations governing services in the UK and the EU. This is heady stuff, in which the WTO itself doesn't have much experience of doing and bringing to a successful negotiation. The Doha round didn't founder on services. We never got anywhere near negotiating over services. They founded over the extent to which and the speed at which we would phase out our distorting agricultural subsidies and barriers and distortions in return for what liberalisation of industrial goods trade would be liberalised in the emerging economies, and we could never find an agreement on those two things. That wouldn't really arise in this negotiation, because essentially our economies are the same. I mean, they have certain national characteristics and distinctions, but basically we are at the same point of development. So those imbalances and those difficulties in reaching a agreement in a multilateral negotiation would not be present in the sort of negotiation we would be having. But here's the point also. On our point of leaving the European Union, there will be regulatory convergence. 40 plus years of regulatory convergence will still exist at the point of our leaving the European Union. The challenge will be sustaining that alignment over time after we have left the European Union. And as that sort of divergence between regulation starts creeping in, which many think inevitably it will, but which you have to really put a lot into withstanding, the moment your regulatory structures and systems and standards and technical norms and requirements, you know, start falling out of alignment, then you have a real difficulty. And a rather unpalatable choice will be faced by us if and when we get round to negotiating a free trade agreement with the United States. The US will say, I know them very well, not an easy bunch to negotiate with in the USTR, I can assure you. I know what they'll say. They'll say, it's services that matter here, not tariffs on goods. It's regulation that shape our trade in services, and if we want more trade in services, then we have to create a reciprocity in our regulation of services. And we know how Americans achieve reciprocity in regulation. We do all the changing and they stay as they are. That is the American way. You know, it's the American way or no way, which will be what drives them in that negotiation. And whilst we could find all sorts of ways in realigning our regulatory approach with that of the United States, and you know, identify all sorts of opportunities for greater trade created from our complying with their regulations, we would progressively, the more we aligned with the United States, fall out of alignment with the European Union, which is our biggest and are effectively our home market. So we will be faced with a very unpalatable choice when it gets to a negotiation with the United States. Do we go the American way and face the risks and sacrifice we would face in the European market, or do we hold what we already have and stick with the European market, because at least we know that it's, you know, in our hands?
Can we squeeze in one quick final question? John Pete, the economist.
Yes, John Pete from The Economist. Can I take you back to Ireland? Bertie Ahern has just said, after a conversation with one of your predecessors, Pascal Lamy, that there are only two choices. Either you have customs controls on the border between north and south, or you have customs controls between the whole island of Ireland and Great Britain. Do you think he's right?
I think he probably is right. I can't see an alternative. I think that is what we're faced with. And I think we really do have to take a step back and consider this in, you know, quite macro political terms. I think that if this, the outcome of this is bad or problematic from everyone's point of view, you're going to find more people in Northern Ireland being faced with a choice between their political allegiance to the United Kingdom and the economic reality of their being part of an all-island economy with the rest of Ireland. And when that tension between politics and economics arises, and you think of the vast number of people who daily cross that non-existent border, either for work or education or trade or whatever it is, you are in danger of saying to those people, no, I'm afraid that because of your allegiance to the UK and its crown, you've got to make that economic sacrifice because we've been unable to put the arrangements in place that will best serve your needs. And that will have political consequences and repercussions in the north of a sort that many people, not all people, but many people will find very unattractive.
Thank you. We're going to have to stop there. Thank you very much for coming. Next Tuesday, Douglas Carswell will be talking to Jill Rutter, the leader of our terrific Brexit team, if you want different answers, if I might put it. And can you join me in thanking Lord Mandelson?